Hello, welcome to the first installment of the in-depth podcast that focuses on black male achievement. This podcast will be different than other JCPS podcasts because, yes, we will focus on people's stories, recognize and celebrate black male achievement, and speak about black male achievement and or issues surrounding it. But also, I want listeners to get to know the guests as well, so it will be lighthearted. And we'll ask questions, some personality questions as well, so you get to know more than what you think you know about our guests. We'll do these once a month for now, and we'll speak to community leaders, JCPS staff, maybe even people with national platforms as well. So without further ado, let's get into our first podcast with District 4 Board Representative and West End School 4th grade teacher, Mr. Joe Marshall.
Hey, what's going on? What's going on?
Okay, Joe, thank you for being my first guest. I'm going to start this out with a tweet that you just tweeted today. He said, "My face when a student asked me today, 'Mr. Marshall, why does this classroom feel like home? Hashtag all, hashtag family, hashtag I teach, hashtag I'ma cry, hashtag love it, hashtag fourth grade, hashtag elementary teacher.'" So I thought that was a great way to start this out because that is a snapshot of what your students think of you. So how did it feel to hear a student say that?
Hey, man, it stopped me in my tracks because I didn't really expect it. Because he's like, "I had a question, Mr. Marshall." And I look at him, we're working, doing some complex sentences and things of that nature. And he looked at me and he said, "Why does this classroom feel like home?" And I just laughed. And I looked at him, I said, "Man, you don't know how that makes Mr. Marshall feel." Because I think that as a teacher, you know, that is our job. Yeah. Our job is to make sure that our classrooms and our schools are safe places for all of our kids.
Right.
And so if you ever stop by the West End School and see my classroom, man, kids got their shoes kicked off. They're working on the floor. They're working collaboratively. Because that's the goal. The goal is not to make them fall in line, but it's really to get them to create their own lines to success. And so, yeah, it felt real good, man.
And I think that's one of the things about when you work with students. It's such hard work. And you can get frustrated and fed up with certain things, but then it's like God always gives you the right student at the right time to say the right thing to make you say, "Dang, I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing."
Yes. Now, and that's the big thing about it. This is a calling.
Right.
If we're gonna work with young people and do this work, and if we're not called to it, this is not a job.
Right.
You know, you have to know that there's a higher calling to this, that we are shaping and molding young minds, while at the same time being open to the effects they can have on us.
Right. Okay, so you're from Lawrenceburg, Kentucky. Tell me, what brought you to Louisville? How long have you been here?
Lawrenceburg, Kentucky, man. Grew up rural, a whole lot of cows, mm-hmm. where I come from, a whole lot of cowboy boots. But came here in 2003 to go to the University of Louisville, go Cards.
Okay.
So proud of my alma mater, proud to be an alumni. Represent the red and black till I die. But ended up majoring in English.
Okay.
And then from there, some opportunities came, started out subbing with JCPS.
Okay.
And I really enjoyed working with young people then, became a director for the YMCA after that, and then finally got into the alternative certification program with the district. So a long kind of history, but from Lawrenceburg to here, been here 16 years now,
okay.
And I call this home.
Okay. So you know this is my first podcast, so let that be the last time that you just say go Cards, because I don't want the UK fans to not listen after the first podcast.
You know, they can feel how they feel, but we're going to use our platform to let them know.
That's good. Okay, so when you think about teaching in the West End, not only being on the school board, but actually making history the night that you were sworn in by being the third black person on the board for the first time ever, and having your daughter there to witness it, please describe the feeling after that first night.
Hey, awestruck, I believe is the word, because I think that the same goes for anyone who's ever been a part of history,
mm-hmm.
is that the history books will always say that moment happened.
Right.
And so to have that documented, to have my daughter there, my mother, my father, my grandmother were there that night, and to see their faces, to let them know that the work that they put in.
Right.
Because I think that's what sometimes gets left out, is that we can make history, but who have been the ones to pave the way for us? And so, you know, I'm ready to do that for my daughter, but I'm also ready to do that for all the students of Jefferson County, because history is going to be made.
Okay.
And that's what I let people know when they ask, well, what is this board going to do now that you're on it that's going to set it apart? We're about to make history in the ways that we're going to look into doing innovative things to decrease this achievement gap for our students.
That's great. And how long, when did you say that I'm going to have my daughter come up, we're going to take a picture? Was that something that you knew immediately, or was that something that night of you said, you know what, I want to get a picture of my daughter? What made you think of that? Because, you know, after it, I came up to you and I shook your hand, looked you in the eye, and I was like, man, as a father, that meant a lot to me, because it made me like, man, when I accomplish certain things, I want my daughter to be with me, because she's only three now, but she's gonna one day look back at the picture and I can tell her about that night and just be proud that she was with me the night when this happened. So when did you come to the realization, yes, I'm gonna have my daughter there?
Someone had asked the question, and they said, would you like your daughter to come up and take a picture?
Okay, good.
And because for me, like, things are flying a mile a minute.
Yeah.
It had only been like 3-4 days since we had got the call from the board.
Right.
And so I'm trying to take everything in.
Phone blowing up.
Right. Phones blowing up. Right. News stations calling.
Right.
And so it was a lot. But for somebody to have that suggestion, it was amazing.
Right.
Because, like you said, my daughter's going to be able to look back at that. And to know the other history that took place that night in voting unanimously for our, you know, Girls of Color Academy.
Right.
I'm telling people, I want to have that picture of my daughter with me the same day I walk her into that building when she gets to middle school.
Amen.
And so those are my goals,
right,
and we're going to fight for that. But, yeah, it was an amazing moment.
Okay, so you a lot of people don't know about West End School. You talked about you try to make your classroom like a home. Can you just tell everyone, like, what West End School is? And I really want to know, why is it so special? I've toured West End School, and it really is a special place. So tell me about West End School.
West End School is a nonprofit private institution for kids from pre-K through eighth grade. Our middle school has a residential component, where they live there from Sunday night through Friday, and our elementary students come and go.
Okay.
It is more nonprofit than it is private, because a lot of people hear private school and they start thinking big money,
right,
parents that have already got, you know, a stable situation, but that's not who we are at all. Our families have to qualify for free reduced lunch on their application. And so when that opportunity came to me to be a Black male teacher in front of Black males, a vulnerable population, I couldn't pass it up. And so that's really who we are. We have one class per grade level, and we really focus on reaching the whole child and not just pushing our curriculum, but making sure that we really are growing young men who are ready to participate in our community.
Okay, now you talked about predominantly Black group of students. In your opinion, why is it important to have a man of color teaching young men of color?
It's the same thing like you just said with your daughter looking up to you. She can say, that's my dad.
Right.
You know, that's who I come from. That's the stock of our family. And for our young men at the same time, they need leaders who they can look up to,
mm-hmm,
who look like them and also can teach from the experience that they're currently living,
mm-hmm,
to say, you know, this is how this curriculum is going to really relate to your life.
Right.
This is where you're really going to use this. And to also know that we've been in situations where teachers haven't always acknowledged our brilliance,
right,
because they couldn't see through our skin color.
Wow.
And so to have someone there who's willing to say, yeah, I know you've had some issues, but in this room, we're going to work through it, and we're going to work through it together in a way that is conducive to your learning.
Right. Okay, so there's not a lot of Black male teachers in JCPS. I believe it's less than 4% of the teachers in JCPS are Black men. If you, and you talked about it being a calling, but we're going to pretend that I'm at the University of Louisville and I got a group of 50 guys who they're about to graduate, or they're going into, they haven't picked a major yet, and they are looking for direction. If you were to go in and try to sell a group of young Black men on why they should consider being teachers, what would you say?
The first thing I would say is marketability, because that was the first thing that kind of drew me to it. All of us want to get into a career field,
mm-hmm,
where there's opportunity and where there isn't going to be a lot of competition. And I can tell you just said the numbers.
Right.
There's not a lot of competition right now for Black male teachers.
Right.
Buildings are looking for you.
Right.
So as you listen to this, you say, what am I going to do? There's an opportunity there for you to have job security,
right,
in knowing that if you go in with the right attitude, the right mindset, and work hard, that a lot of people will hire you,
right,
and they'll hold on to you. But second, I will say that we're going to be going through within the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to redefine what teaching is.
Okay.
Because I think that traditionally teaching doesn't fit a lot of people's career aspects.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we're able to redefine that as an opportunity for mentorship,
right.
For personal growth, and opportunity to secure the future,
mm-hmm.
I think framing it that way can get a lot of black males excited that you can go in a place
mm-hmm.
Where you got your room.
Right.
And that's your world, and you get a chance to go in there and be the king of that world,
right.
And raise up other kings and queens.
Right.
And so when you look at it from that perspective, if you can't get excited that way,
right.
Then maybe it isn't for you. Right. But that's the stuff that gets me excited about getting up every day.
Yeah, I say less than 4%. I don't know if people really, because it really shocked me being part of JCPS. When you go on the website, and this tool's on the JCPS website where you can see the demographics of the teachers at each school, and it's astounding that there are elementary schools with one black teacher in the school, and that's it, you know? So it's just, I don't know if people really can grasp the lack of diversity in our teachers and in our administration in JCPS, but it's something to JCPS's credit that we've recognized and we're working to correct.
Yeah, there's a lot of great initiatives that are going on,
right.
That our district is saying, look, we can acknowledge that there is an achievement gap.
Right.
We can acknowledge and even talking to parents and saying we apologize,
mm-hmm.
because we have lost a lot of good faith and a lot of families who have seen their children come through the system and not reach their full potential.
Right.
And so I think now is the time to start making those changes. Now is the time to acknowledge those things and be innovative,
right.
in what we do. We're going to have to be brave,
right.
in what we do in JCPS. We're going to have to be groundbreaking.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of places we're going to be able to look and say, well, let's do it like Baltimore did, or let's do it like Chicago. No, people are going to be looking at Louisville and saying, what did Louisville do? Because,
right.
obviously they did something so outside the box, mm-hmm. that it worked.
Right.
And so you have to be willing to do that in order to change the current progression of teaching.
Wow. Okay, so part of my goal and my role is to demystify the myths surrounding young men of color. What do you think the biggest misconception is, or the greatest thing about young men of color that people that don't work with them every day at such a young age like you do, that they may not know?
I'm going to say this very clearly. Black children are children too. Research shows that people look at our children,
wow.
and automatically assume that they are 5 to 10 years older than they really are.
Wow.
They are children just like everyone else.
Wow.
And so we've also seen that referrals, suspensions, our children are getting suspended for the same activities at twice, maybe even sometimes 3 times the rate of other children. And so we have to demystify that our children are extra grown or that they are more aggressive than anybody else.
Right.
Our children are children too. And so when you look at an 8-year-old black child as an 8-year-old child, you realize he's gonna act like an 8-year-old child.
Correct.
And so it's our job to look at them through that lens and to help them grow in an age-appropriate way. Because I can't tell you how many times I've seen it happen, because some of our kids have grown up too quick, too soon.
Right.
But school should be the place where they get to be kids again,
yeah.
and where we appreciate their innocence and their youth, and we don't try to break it ourselves.
Well, you saying that, I just want to know, do we have your permission to blow up a picture of you and to put that as a quote, black children are children too? Because I felt, as another black man, I felt that. Like, I don't know if everybody that's listening will feel that, but I feel that. So that was awesome, man.
I appreciate it.
All right, so you attended University of Louisville. The student demographics are 74% white to 11.2% black, and the faculty 74.6% white versus 9.9% black. Looking back on the experience, and I don't know the demographics of Lawrenceburg, Kentucky, but you were a black man who went to a predominantly white institution. What challenges came with that, if any, and if so, how did you navigate it? And I'm asking this because there may be another young man that's considering going to a predominantly white institution, but I think a lot of times people look at athletic teams as the representation of the school, and a lot of times that's not the correct representation of what the student population is. For instance, I had a friend in college who went to University of Tennessee, and he said he was in classes where he was the only black man. But if you look at the University of Tennessee football team, basketball team, that's pretty much all you see is black,
yep.
people. So
yep.
What challenges came with that, and if so, how did you navigate it?
So growing up in Anderson County in Lawrenceburg, We graduated a class of 225 from our high school. Mm-hmm. Five of us were black.
Okay.
And so that kind of gives you an idea where I come from.
Okay.
So I wouldn't say that going to a predominantly white institution shocked me, but what I will say,
you had more in college than
there you go. Like, that was the thing okay. for me coming right. from where I come from. I actually went someplace where I was like, oh, my people.
Right,
like,
right. Okay.
Like,
okay.
I got some backup now. Like, and so, like, for me, I think that's what it is that we create community wherever we go.
Okay.
And so it's important to latch on to each other and help each other. And so being given a lot of leadership opportunities mm-hmm. helped me as well at U of L. But I think that it's important for us to know that within the world, we're going to have to navigate many spaces. And so you're not always going to be in all white spaces or all black spaces or all Latino spaces. We're going to be together in this. And so my experiences with great leadership that I had some great black mentors, I had some great white mentors as
right,
well.
Right.
People who recognize a lot of things within me. A supervisor I had once told me, she said, Joe, you got to start taking yourself seriously.
Mm-hmm.
She was like, because a lot of times you put yourself down just because you think other people are. And that sticks with me today. And so I think that that's how we have to look at it, is that, you know, we're going to create our communities in these spaces. But at the same time, you know, we need to take our community to other spaces, because I know friends of mine who went with me to U of L,
mm-hmm.
who were not used to the black spaces.
Yeah.
And so allowing them to experience that, to watch it change them as well, to say, oh, this is the experience from which you've been living,
yeah.
and now I'm able to see it firsthand. So if there is a black male like me who's saying, you know, I want to go to an institution that's mostly white, I say go for the opportunity and the calling that's been given you,
right.
Especially if the scholarship dollars are there,
because right,
right. it can be tough to pay for school. So
right.
whatever opportunities are there, take them and just go be great.
Okay. We're about to get into some personality questions, but one more question. You've been in your District 4 seat for how long now?
A little over 3 weeks.
Okay, so you brand new.
Almost a month.
So I know it's only been 3 weeks, but how has the experience been so far, and why should you continue to represent District 4? Because I know you're about to campaign again, or you're constantly campaigning.
Yeah, constantly.
Constantly campaigning. So how has it been so far, and why should people vote for you when it's time to vote?
So first I'll say it's been amazing so far. Teaching in JCPS sometimes leads you to say, you know, who's the person at the top making these decisions
mm-hmm.
that trickle down to the effects that affect the classroom? So now I know, and I'm at that table.
Right.
And so in order to be the best representative I can for our students and our teachers, I think it's all about my classroom experience.
Right.
You know, I'm the guy that I'm already getting up every day.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going into a room teaching 9 and 10 year old boys. I've done it in JCPS before. And so that wealth of experience has already informed a lot of the things that I've already talked with the current board about. And I think this board is looking to be progressive, and I've got a lot of progressive ideas. And so District 4, the Southwest, you know, part of Louisville, is very blue collar.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a hard working area.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I grew up with a mother and father that both work factory jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I've worked in those same factories myself. And so I identify with the people, I identify with the area, but I identify with the hard workers on the front lines every day.
So I think that's great, because people can't say you don't understand, because you're doing
Hey, I'm doing it every day. Hey, I'm up late at night. Matter of fact, I got a backpack full of papers to grade tonight. So I know what they're going through.
All right. So just real quick before we get you out of here, just want to ask you some personality questions so people can know the Joe that they don't always get to see. So tell us what your favorite TV show is right now.
Ooh, favorite TV show. Let's go Netflix.
Okay.
And let's go with Stranger Things. So
really?
The last season of Stranger Things was amazing. I'm a sci-fi guy, and I like mystery and things of that nature. So, yeah, I'm going to go Stranger Things on that.
So I've seen two of the episodes from the last season.
Okay.
But I'm the type of person that I have to have complete silence. I can't have distractions.
Yeah.
And I got a 3-year-old
who
likes to stay up late. So it's hard for me to see the rest of it. So don't give me any spoilers.
No spoilers.
Okay. What's the weirdest fact or quirk about you?
Weirdest fact or quirk. Funny thing, I can't set the volume on my radios to odd numbers. I can't do it.
I can't
either. Okay,
if my wife thinks I'm crazy. So let me ask you this. What about pumping gas? Does it have to be at a round number on gas?
Yes. Too? So, like, if it goes to, like, 0-1, I got to go up to, like, 0-5. Right. Like, it's got to be, like, multiples of 2 or 5 or something to make sense. But odd numbers outside of multiples of 5, I can't do it. Man, I can't do it.
Man, I really respect. Like, that you just spoke to me. So, even me, I can do it to a crazy number if it makes sense.
Yes.
So, say, for instance, I get to 2305. 2 + 3 = 5. Okay. So I'm cool with that. But it can't be like 1905 because it's like that don't make sense.
That don't make sense.
But I'm an alpha, so it could be 1906.
Okay.
So it's just.
It's got to make sense. Like, gotta make I can do 23 because of MJ.
Right.
Because then it makes sense there. Like, I can do like other numbers, but it's got to be significant. So, like, my wife will like turn it up. I'm like, you didn't even watch what you turned it to. We sitting here on 19 right now. Then we got bad karma in the car.
And 19 makes no sense. 19 makes no sense. That's the dumbest thing, volume number. Anyway, okay. What's your favorite restaurant or meal that you eat?
For me, I'm a cook. So that's my place in the house. So I go in the kitchen, I get my pots and my pans. I'm gonna tell you now, I make a whole chicken on my grill that'll knock your socks off.
Okay.
With like homemade jerk rub.
Oh, okay.
Like, come on now. Like, I can really hook that thing up. So yeah.
We said meal, so chicken, and what you gonna cook on
the side? So what I do is I do that whole chicken, and then I do like some garlic mashed potatoes on the side, and then throw a little like green and yellow squash medley on there, because you got to have them veggies in there, you know.
Okay. Yeah, I'll come eat, but I'm not going to eat the squash.
I'm
like squash.
We're going to make you try it, man.
Okay. What's one thing you don't mind spending money on to get the best version of it? So, example, I like cheese, and I don't care about getting the cheapest cheese. I buy Sargento because that's my favorite cheese. So, what's something you don't mind spending money on to get the best version of it?
I say, for me, that's going to be, I'll say travel.
Okay.
So
are you saying like to the airplane? Or?
So I'm saying like hotel. Like if I got a choice of where I'm going to sleep while I'm like on vacation, then I don't mind like putting another $50, $60 a night.
To get the window room.
To get that window room with that nice view, you know.
See, me and my wife butt heads on that because she's the way you are.
Okay.
But I'm thinking if we stay in 5 nights and that's $60, that's $300 we could spend on other stuff. $60 a night. But I respect that. If I ask your daughter to describe you in one sentence, what would she say?
My daddy is silly,
okay. What could you give a 30-minute presentation on with absolutely no preparation? But we're not talking about English or anything that you teach in school.
Yeah.
Something outside of school.
Comedy.
So do you think you could do stand-up?
Oh, yeah. No, I'm ready. I got a 30-minute set at the house right now.
Okay, well, this is supposed to be quick, but give us one joke real quick.
Huh?
One joke?
Look, safe for TV or not?
Safe for TV. We want you to get rid of
We need to get the votes. I give you one to my kid. At school hit me with one day. He said, Mr. Marsh, I got a pizza joke for you. I said, what is it? He said, never mind, it's too cheesy.
We still want you to vote for
me. Right.
Okay. What book has impacted you the most?
John Maxwell's Good Leaders Ask Great Questions.
Okay.
It totally reshaped the way that I have interactions with people, the way that I seek to listen before I speak. It's an amazing book.
Okay. And last question. If you were forced to relive one 10-minute block of your life, which block would you choose?
The day my daughter was born.
That's the same way
I feel. I can't get over like just the events of the night, but the moment that like she came into the world. And, like, you know, I wasn't even concerned with everybody. It was like, do you want to hold her skin to skin?
Right.
Like, I'm a big dude. My shirt immediately came off. Like, I wasn't worried about no nurses, no doctors. Like, yes, like, give me my baby right now. So
second to last question, because that's actually the moment I would choose. But the reason I would is because I feel like I was so shocked and I was traumatized because of what all I saw that I feel like I didn't actually get to experience it. So do you like remember it moment for moment, or did you kind of black out and just try? Because I was just trying to keep from passing out.
I remember that like it was yesterday because so much was going on.
Now,
because my wife is like you in that moment. Like everything's just happening and like she's just doing her thing. And so I got to be locked in. Because I got to speak to her and tell her, like, you know, let's stay focused. And so remember the events of that night and what happened is just still so vivid even 3 years later.
So it was just hard for me because, you know, she has a contractions and you try to say, you got this, blah, 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 blah. But after like 30 minutes, you run out of stuff to say.
Yeah.
Because you just said everything already. So either you're going to repeat yourself or just be quiet. So I just got quiet.
Right.
So anyway, give us your social media info so people can follow and keep up with you.
Yeah. So hit us up on Twitter at Joe4D4. Same thing on Facebook.com/Joe4D4. It's all about that hashtag Joe for Foe. You know, the Wendy's got the 4 for 4, right, but we say it's that 4 for 4. So Joe, we on that Joe for Foe movement. Okay. So drop that hashtag on Facebook, on Twitter. Come see us. We'll be making our rounds to all the District 4 open houses within the next few weeks. So look for us out in the community.
Well, I knew that you would be a great first interview because I saw your interviews on the news station and you were like, it's like you weren't trying to be politically correct or just trying to be buttoned up for TV. You was like, yeah. I said, I want him for my first one. So thank you so much for being here.
Well, we got to be like that because at the end of the day, this is about our children. Mm-hmm. This is about the future of education in Jefferson County. Right. And so if you're not excited like that, if you want to come into this all buttoned up and proper, we ain't got time for that.
Right. People see the real you.
Right. It's
you.
Time to be real about it. It's time to be honest, but it's time to do some great things. So I appreciate you having me.
Okay. So Joe Marshall, District 4 representative, West End school teacher, and avid University of Kentucky fan.
I know, don't end it on that. You're going to get me hurt in these streets, man.
Thank you for coming, man.
Hey, appreciate you.